Thank you, everyone, for your warm introductions. I wish I could see your faces to thank you in person, but we'll get to that later. So to kick things off, I want to just quickly talk about how I came to be the person I am today and share my life's journey with you, because there were some ups and downs and a lot of pivots that were involved in that process. So as you can see quickly, I want to give you some of the tools that I've used and some of the elements that I've put together into a methodology that allowed me to empower myself and turn into the individual I am. Now, many of us know the book Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and it's a story about a child who grew up having a blue-collar father who taught him a lot of very important things and very valuable things and very valuable insights, but wasn't able to really give the insights necessary to allow that child to flourish in the business world and to go out and actually be an entrepreneur. And that really stuck with me. And through the advent of technology, I thought, wow, I don't only need to have one rich dad and one poor dad, I can have multiple dads or multiple moms out there that can help me out. And that's what technology brought to me. So I want to share that story with you. And as any punk kid would do when they decided that they weren't happy with a job, and just to give you a little bit of background, I got lucky out of college, out of university, and had a job with a Fortune 100 company. And I thought, how amazing is that? How great is that? It felt fantastic. 3 years down the line, I started to feel, you know what? This isn't exactly what I was hoping for. It wasn't exactly what I thought this was going to be. I thought I was going to be trained, be coddled, be given opportunities to move up the ladder, have a mentor around me. But instead, I felt like I was just a number. So I did what any other punk digital millennial kid would do and said, screw this. I'm going to go look for something better. So I decided to turn to LinkedIn and figure out what was out there for me. What is my passion? What do I want to do? Well, I know I like social media, so why don't I find out what local social media companies are out there that I could join? So I did a search on LinkedIn and just started from A to Z and found out there was a beautiful local company called Hootsuite that had just started and was right in my realm of expertise. So I went down there, put in my application. 2 weeks later, I had quit my job with my Fortune 100 company and moved into a job with 35 people in a small, stinky room where one day you might be the janitor and the next day you might be the marketing manager, but I loved it. So it all started in Vancouver in the poorest zip code or postal code in Canada, on Railway Street in Vancouver, British Columbia. And the reason why that was so important is it made sure that every person we began hiring and started to hire to build our culture as a company followed certain guidelines. And one of those was to be egoless. And I don't know about you, but if you had an ego, you did not want to walk down that street to your office each and every day. So part of picking our location was a strategic way of us making sure that everyone who joined our company during those early stages shared the same cultural values that we wanted to portray as a company. And one of those was to be egoless, to empower others, to have a work environment where we shared with each other and collaborated instead of competed with each other. And that's exactly what happened. And 2 weeks into my job, I realized very quickly how much power a small group of people had. Now, many of you remember the Egyptian Revolution that happened. And of course, before that, the Libyan Revolution. And the one common thing that tied those two revolutions together was technology, was social media, right? With the Libyan Revolution, people were using Facebook and Twitter to mobilize and to plan, where can we protest? How can we show in great force that we're going to stand up to a tyrannical government that's out there? And what Egypt quickly learned in the same situation was, we don't want this to happen. We don't want people to mobilize and protest and come at us. So what the president at the time did was decided to turn off all access to social media platforms. So nobody could use Twitter. Nobody could use Facebook, essentially immobilizing them so that they couldn't come together and make a proper protest and couldn't get the groups large enough necessary to make a difference. But over the weekend, something very, very strange happened. We came into the office and we saw this graph right here. And we said, how is this possible? Our user base just grew 7,000% overnight. And I don't know if many of you know what Hootsuite is, but it's a social media platform that allows people to log into one space and share via different social networks. So although the government had cut off all access to Facebook and Twitter, they had no idea about this tiny little company sitting in Vancouver that just happened to be at the same time, at the same place, that also provided access to those social networks. So activists on the ground found this out very, very quickly. And they spread that news very, very quickly. And all of a sudden, all of the users flocked to Hootsuite and started using our program to mobilize, to get large groups together, to protest, and to fight back against a tyrannical government. And that day, to this day, and I wish that I could show you my arms because you would feel the goosebumps and see the goosebumps on my arms, is I knew I made the right decision and I knew I went to the right place. And that was the first moment in my life that I felt that I made the right decision and chose a pathway where I empowered myself to take control of my career. And that was an incredible feeling. And what I realized was I wasn't searching for a company to work for. I was actually searching for the opposite, the uncompany. Something that didn't put profits over people, but something that put people over profits. And that's what our company was founded on. And the first 100 employees, not one resume was submitted. It was all referrals because we all shared the same view, the same values. We wanted to be bigger than just what we could be as a collective. We wanted to change the world. And through our work during the Egyptian Revolution, we knew we could do that. We were empowered to do that. And we knew that we had created something that wasn't the standard company, but was rather the uncompany, and took the opposite approach at what business truly is. And part of that meant forming a culture. Culture is so important. Whether it's a country, a continent, the way that culture shifts is important. It can turn things one way or it can turn things completely the opposite. And in our case, we wanted to create a good culture that empowered people, that allowed people to flourish, that allowed people an open environment to work in, to collaborate with people from different departments, to have access to a CEO when you'd never have access to a vice president, for example. Now we had access to a CEO. So what we were looking for was a culture to build on and make sure that while we scaled from 20, 25 people all the way up to 1,000 people, which we did in 3 years, which was incredible, that we maintained that culture. And what you're looking at here is a typical Friday after work at Hootsuite. It was very common for 100% of our employees to not go home at 4:30 or 5 p.m., but in fact, to stay until 7 or 8 p.m. playing beer pong together. And for those of you who don't know beer pong, it's throwing a ping pong ball into small glasses, and of course, the loser gets to drink the beer. And that was part of our culture. And it allowed us to just take off our dress jackets for a little bit and say, hey, here's 2 hours that we're spending together as a company where we don't talk business. We just hang out, get to know each other, and share our stories and values and become closer to one another as a company. And as you can see, as the summertime came, our culture didn't shift very much at all, did it? That's for sure. But again, this was an opportunity for us to spend time with our CEOs, with the rest of the people that might have been siloed off into other areas in our company, and just have that experience to know one another and to really get to know each other by the heart, not just by the water cooler talk or the superficial highs. And this was a really, really important step in our growth. And then things got pretty real. We received $175 million in investment, which is the highest number that's ever been allotted to a technology company in Canadian history, which was amazing. So we left our humble beginnings on Railway Street in Vancouver and moved into a little bit more of a respectable place in Mount Pleasant, Vancouver, British Columbia, much more of a nicer setting. And we still tried to maintain that culture. We built a gym in the office. We had a nap room. We had an open concept. We had a bring your dogs to work rule was okay. Of course, nobody dared use the nap room for fear of being labeled, but that's a different story. We did have a nap room. But we had a gym. We had beer kegs. We had all the ingredients to scale a culture and really empower people to bring their best to work every day because they knew each and every one of them around them. And that's what we did. But I started to realize at that stage, there was limitations. I was empowered before. I was having fun. I was moving up. But when we received that amount of funding, something changed. And there was a glass ceiling put over a lot of people. And that upward growth and trajectory and vertical movement that I thought was always going to be available to me at this company was now taken away because we had this money. Now we could go out and poach and take people from other companies and say, oh, the vice president of IBM, oh, the vice president of Microsoft. Why don't we bring them on board because they've been through this experience before? So I decided to take that on as a challenge. My company had empowered me up to that point. But what about empowering myself? What could I do? And this began my journey of self-empowerment and figuring out how I can empower myself through the use of technology and social media. Now, the first thing that I learned was the most important part of self-empowerment was building yourself a fortress. And that means surrounding yourself with the people that can make you most successful. And every year you should reevaluate who these people are and make sure that your fortress is the strongest it can be. Now, as a young person growing up, my fortress was, well, who can be the people that can mentor me, that can teach me, well, what are the mistakes I'm making? How do I not make big mistakes? How do I make decisions the right way? And of course, as I grew older, my fortress changed. It started to look more like, okay, well, I need a good doctor around me, a good dentist around me, right? A good orthopedist. Around me. And your fortress changes over time, and it depends on your needs and what success you're looking for or what you want to achieve that year. So my first step was building my fortress, and I identified 7 people around the world that I would be able, or if I could sit down with them to have a coffee, that I would love to ask them certain questions that could be beneficial to my life. So step 2 was my development of what I call a personal learning network, or PLN, which is just another fancier term for my fortress. And those 7 people, I started to map out and say, okay, well, nowadays, you know, before we used to be disconnected by such amount of degrees of people, but with the advent of the internet and social media, basically, we are connected some way, shape, or form to anyone in the world through maybe 2 or 3 connections, when it used to be way more than that in the past. And I realized by mapping this out that all 7 people I identified in my fortress were literally only 2 or 3 degrees away from me through other connections. So I thought, okay, well, this is the age of social media, of technology. Why be shy? Why not go for it? Why not reach out? Why not give it a shot? So an example would be Grant Cardone, one of the easily most identified top 5 business sales influencers in the entire world, receives thousands, if not thousands, of phone calls and emails every day. So I decided to take a different approach. I decided to say, why don't I add value to Grant before reaching out, before asking for something? So that's what I did. I started liking a lot of his posts on social media, commenting on a lot of posts on social media, building a little bit of a social contract or building social currency up with Grant. And you know what? After about 2 months of doing this, I reached out to him, sent him a direct message, and we began a friendship that I hope lasts lifelong. And to this day, I can reach out to Grant and have his personal phone number and ask him for advice. And these are people who I never thought I would ever have a chance to sit down at a table with and have a cup of coffee. And by taking this approach, identifying who your fortress is, and using the power of technology that you all have in your hands, probably right now or in your pockets, and hopefully your ringers are off, you have that tool that allows you to reach out to anyone. And if you do it the right way, you can build your fortress regardless of geographical boundaries or geographical barriers. We used to be bound by those. Now we don't have that. We have the ability to use the internet to eliminate geographical boundaries, to talk to people in continents that we never even have been to or imagined traveling to. And that's the power of social networking. Now, I want to kind of leave you all with a quote by Malcolm Gladwell, who stated that 10,000 hours is the typical amount of time that you need to put in to your craft before you call yourself an expert or can be considered an expert. And if I could say, what was the one piece of advice that every single one of the members of my fortress gave me when I would speak to them on a regular basis, was make sure whatever it is that you do, you're passionate about it. Because if you're not passionate about what you do, you're not going to put in the extra time that you need. You're not going to give your craft the love and care that it deserves. You're not going to give 100% at your job. You're not going to stop looking at the clock wishing it's 4:30 or coffee break. The people that really are passionate about what they do hone their craft day after day, put in the time, and that's exactly what I did, because each and every one of them were telling me the same thing. Be passionate, put your time in, your time will come. And that's what I did. I did social media work for people for free. I did freelancing jobs. I blog posted for anybody who wanted blog posts for their business. I put in 10,000 hours plus and as fast as I could. And by the time I was 32, I was in Forbes magazine as one of the top 30 social media influencers in the world. And that's not because I did that myself. I was there because I had the advice of my fortress, the right way to make decisions and to avoid the big mistakes and the pitfalls. And if I can say one thing in my talk today to everybody in here, it's build your fortress, connect with your fortress, use social media, network. That's what it's there for. So if I could leave you all with one thing today, is build your fortress. Don't wait until next year. Don't wait until January 1st. Start today. Thank you very much.